Okay. Hari Om. All of you are awake?
Fairly.
Okay. Yeah, you are melting, but I am asking just because you had your sweet chapati. So I felt you are all sleeping. No? Okay, start with a session related with practice of yoga during pregnancy or prenatal yoga. Now, as such, with some limitations, yoga can be practiced during pregnancy. Now, in this session, we will be talking about the importance of practice or importance of practicing yoga during pregnancy. We will not be talking about any specific positions as such, because it would be too difficult to explain the effects of each and every position when practiced during pregnancy. Or we will not be dealing with what is to be practiced during pregnancy. Actually, there is a list which I have already made that what positions can be practiced and which positions cannot be practiced. I'll just put a photocopy outside on the notice board so that you can just go through that list, what is to be practiced during pregnancy and what positions are not to be practiced during pregnancy. Like for the different duration, like the first 3 months, the second 3 months and the last 3 months, what can be practiced and what cannot be practiced. This a list already has been made up, so you can just refer to the photocopy which I'll be putting it outside on the notice board. So in this session we will be just dealing with the importance, the significance of practicing yoga during pregnancy. Now as such, talking about pregnancy, it is definitely the development of the child, and for this development of the child, it's a prerequisite that the mother herself should be healthy, because it would be a healthy baby for a healthy mother. So the prerequisite, basically, it would be a healthy mother. And when we talk about healthy mother, it should be a harmony at three different levels. You can call it as the mind, body and soul. These three different levels, if the mother is very well balanced at these three levels, like mentally, physically and you can say spiritually, then and then only it's possible for a healthy pregnancy and a healthy childbirth. Now for this reason, the practice of yoga, it should start even before pregnancy. Like yoga can be practiced during pregnancy, no doubt about it, or even if someone wants to newly start the practice of yoga during pregnancy, it is also possible. But the ideal way would be practicing yoga even before pregnancy. Now this practice of yoga, a regular practice of yoga before pregnancy, it would give some advantages. The first one is the flexibility. Now this flexibility, it is basically essential, basically necessary during the process of childbirth. At the physical level, the flexibility which would be essential, which would be beneficial during the process of childbirth, and ideally we know all that yoga, practice of yogic positions can improve the flexibility. The second prerequisite would be vitality. Now this vitality, if I just put it in simple words, I would say it is enough, it is sufficient supply of oxygen to the body and efficient removal of toxins from the body. It can increase your vitality. And we all, by this time, we are aware that this improved supply of oxygen or removal of toxins or removal of waste from the body, it can be effectively achieved with the practice of pranayama. So that is again a part which can be practiced even before pregnancy. And the last one, what we talked about, was the spiritual development. Now this spiritual development, it can be achieved with the practice of meditation, with the practice of yoga nidra, with the practice of omkar chanting. So at these three different levels, the health, it can be improved even before pregnancy. Like the flexibility at the physical level, which can be improved with the practice of yogic positions, various yogic positions. The vitality, or in simple words, the improved supply of oxygen and efficient removal of waste from the body. It can be achieved with the practice of pranayama or the breathing techniques. And lastly, the spiritual development. I am using here the word spiritual development. You, in the simpler words, you can even say forget about spiritual development. It can be even the emotional and mental development also, which can be achieved with the practice of certain concentration techniques, meditation and yoga nidra, including you can say omkar chanting. Now, as I have already said that the practice of yoga, it is essential, it is beneficial even before pregnancy. So there are certain areas, certain parts of the body where the mother, she should concentrate on developing the efficiency of those particular parts. The first one would be abdominal muscles. Now, the abdominal muscles, it would be important to work on the abdominal muscles, as these would be the muscles which would help to maintain the position of the baby and the uterus, or the position of the baby and the mother's womb, which is now growing in size. So the position, it can be maintained, it would help in maintaining the position of the baby, of the uterus, in a proper way if the abdominal muscles, they are strong enough. So it would be even before pregnancy that these abdominal muscles, they should be worked on. Now, as I have already said, what are the positions for the abdominal muscles? Ideally, you would get it in the photocopy. I have just mentioned the names, that these positions, when practiced, they would improve the strength, they would improve the efficiency of the abdominal muscles. So you can just go through the list, and those positions can be helpful before pregnancy to improve the strength of the abdominal muscles. The second group, or the second area which needs to be concentrated, is the lower back. Now, the lower back muscles, they are important just because most of the times it's a common complaint during pregnancy of lower backache. And this lower backache is because of abnormal position, or it is just because the center of gravity, the balance of the body is slightly disturbed because of the growing weight of the baby. So for that reason, the lower back muscles, they are strained too much during pregnancy. Extra strain for proper balancing, it comes on the lower back muscles. So if the lower back muscles, they are trained previously itself, even before pregnancy, if the lower back muscles, they are trained properly, they can hold the position, especially of the vertebral column of the spinal cord. If it is maintained in an upright position, then the lower backache would be reduced up to a certain extent. So again, the lower back muscles, they are the second area which need to be concentrated. And the last group of muscles, which is of the most important, is the pelvic muscles. Now, these pelvic muscles, they are the muscles, primary muscles we would say, which would actually hold the uterus during pregnancy, and at the same time they would help in the process of childbirth. So these pelvic muscles, they have a double role to play. Like during pregnancy, they need to have sufficient strength to hold the position of the baby, to hold the uterus in a proper position, and to support the baby. So these pelvic muscles during pregnancy, for the 9 months of pregnancy, they need to be strong enough. But on the other hand, during the process of childbirth, these are the same muscles which are going to relax, and they would allow, or they would help to push the baby outside. So these muscles, they have double work or double role. It's strength and at the same time flexibility. As far as the abdominal muscles are concerned, it's only the strength which is important. But for the pelvic muscles, they should be strong enough, and on the other hand, they should be flexible enough so that they can assist during the process of childbirth. So if these three areas, as far as the physical level is concerned, if these three areas are worked more, they are concentrated more, they would be helpful during pregnancy. So it is the abdominal muscles, the lower back muscles, and the pelvic muscles. So the positions, the yogic positions, they should be more targeted, they should be more oriented towards improving the strength and flexibility of these three groups of muscles. Now, in short, we would just try to understand about the common physiological changes during pregnancy, and then the necessity of yoga for practicing to combat these physical changes. Now, these are normal physiological changes. I repeat, these are normal physiological changes. They are not diseases. They are just because of some changes going on in the mother's body that these things or these complaints, they are experienced by the mother. So it's not a disease as such, but it is a physiological change which can occur during pregnancy. So for that, first we start with blood and circulation, or the circulatory system and the blood. Now, as we all know that the baby is dependent on the mother for the supply of nutrition, for the supply of oxygen and all the essentials for life. So to supply this nutrients, to supply the oxygen to the baby, the total quantity of blood in the mother's body, it increases. During pregnancy, it is said that around 20% of blood, it increases. So if the mother, she has 5 liters of blood usually, then it would increase by 20% during pregnancy. It is essential to maintain a proper blood flow, a proper circulation, and supply nutrients and other food substances to that particular you can say baby. So this 20% of extra blood, it would help in supplying nutrition to the baby. But on the other hand, as far as the mother is concerned, for the mother it is an extra load over the heart, because the heart, mother's heart, before pregnancy and during pregnancy, it is the same. It is the same muscles, it is the same amount of muscles, the same amount of fibers. But before pregnancy, this muscle, this heart, it was pumping out 5 liters of blood, and during pregnancy, now it is going to pump out 20% extra blood. So it is going to be a overload, overwork for the heart. And because of this, the common complaint which comes up is palpitations. The mother can feel her heart beating. That's because of this extra blood which the heart has to pump out. So palpitations would be one of the common complaints during pregnancy. And it may go on increasing as the months of pregnancy they go on increasing, because then it becomes more and more difficult to maintain the circulation. Now the second system which needs to be taken note of is the respiratory system. Now in the respiratory system, the demand for oxygen is increasing, because the mother is now supplying blood, supplying oxygen to the baby, and at the same time she needs oxygen for herself. So the demand for oxygen is increasing, but on the other hand, the movements of the respiratory muscle, they become restricted, because when the baby grows in size, it compresses over the respiratory muscle, and the movements of the respiratory muscle, they become restricted. So there is a restriction on the movements of the respiratory muscle, and on the other hand, the demand for oxygen is increasing. At the same time, the baby is producing carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide needs to be removed from the body, and the work is done again by the respiratory system of the mother, because for a child, the baby, the respiratory system is not functional. So it demands oxygen, and on the other hand, the carbon dioxide which is produced by the baby, the mother herself has to throw it out. So the work of the respiratory system is increased, but the movements of the diaphragm, they become restricted. It becomes difficult for the movements of the diaphragm. So it leads to one of the again common complaints, what we can say is breathlessness. So usually palpitations and breathlessness, these things, they would go hand in hand, because of lack of, you can say, because of reduced movements of the respiratory muscles. The next system which we can take a note of is the digestive system. Now in the digestive system, again the situation is the same. The demand is increased, the demand for nutrition, it increases, and it is said usually that the demand for nutrition increases during pregnancy around 750 to 1000 calories a day. The mother requires more 750 to 1000 calories a day during pregnancy, just to give enough nutrition to the baby. So the demand increases, but on the other hand, the absorption of food, it becomes difficult. Because the intestines, the stomach and the intestine or the digestive system, it is compressed. The size of the baby, it would compress the intestines and the rate of absorbing food, it would reduce. It would become sluggish. It would not stop, but it would become sluggish. It would happen slowly. The rate of absorption, it would be slow. So the rate of absorption is slow and the demand for nutrition is more, just because of the compression of the intestines. And the other effect of this compression is a common complaint of constipation. Like if the intestines are compressed, then there would be a complaint of constipation during pregnancy. And the last but the most important, I would say, it would be the mental changes or the psychological changes which are to be taken note of. Now these psychological changes, these mental changes, they would be different for different women. It would depend on the circumstances, it would depend upon the situations, but definitely there are certain psychological changes which take place during pregnancy. And one of them, the common to all of them, would be fear and anxiety. Most of the times it would be fear and anxiety during pregnancy, and especially this fear and anxiety, it would be because of some incorrect information or halfway information collected from the friends and family members, especially about the process of childbirth. So this is the incorrect information which probably the mother tries to collect, the halfway information about actually the process of childbirth, so that it leads to fear and anxiety actually about the process of childbirth. So these changes, they would be some physiological changes which can take place during pregnancy. Now as I have said earlier, it would be practically not possible to consider each and every position, what is the effect of each and every position, but we can take into consideration certain important parts of yogic practices, the effect of them. To start with, we can have the effect of pranayama. Now pranayama, definitely it can be practiced during pregnancy, no doubt about it, but ideally it would be that the practice of pranayama, it is started before pregnancy and it is continued through in the pregnancy. That is, initially the mother was in a habit of practicing pranayama and it is continued through pregnancy. If it is to be started during pregnancy, then maybe it is restricted only to the process of deep breathing. Only deep breathing, not actual pranayams as such. And personally, I would suggest that even pranayam during pregnancy, they should be practiced without the breath holding, the kumbhaka. Only pranayam without breath holding, it would be more beneficial. Now, actually, the effects of pranayam, the advantage of pranayam, number one, it would be definitely more supply of oxygen, that we have already dealt with in the lecture on respiratory system, that practice of pranayam, it can supply more oxygen to the body. So practicing deep breathing, practicing pranayam, it would actually supply oxygen to the body, and at the same time it would help in removal of carbon dioxide from the body. That is one basic advantage which pranayam can give. Second important advantage of pranayam is the rhythmic movement of the respiratory muscle. The controlled movement of the respiratory muscle, the controlled movement, the up and down movement of the respiratory muscle, it would help in improving the circulation in the abdominal area. So again, the rhythmic contractions and relaxations of the respiratory muscle, the rhythmic movement, the regular movements of the respiratory muscle, it would help in improving the circulation, to be very specific, in the abdominal area, and in general it would help in maintaining the circulation. So another complaint like palpitations, which was because of improper circulation or too much of load over the heart, that complaint of palpitation, it can be reduced. And at the same time, the blood flow towards the abdominal organs, it is increased. Now when the blood flow towards the abdominal organs is increased, the baby is going to get more nutrition, no doubt about it, because the baby is also in the uterus at the abdominal area. So the baby is going to get more nutrition, but on the other hand, the amount of food being absorbed is going to increase, because if a proper blood supply is maintained towards the intestines, towards the stomach, the food absorption, it would increase. So pranayama is not only related with the respiratory system, it's going to have an effect on other systems also. Like, it's going to help in improving the circulation, and on the other hand, it's also going to help in improving the absorption. So it is going to have effect on three different systems. The respiratory system, getting more oxygen and removal of carbon dioxide, is the very basic advantage. But apart from that, improving circulation, improving the absorption of food, they would be the additional advantages of practicing pranayama during pregnancy. Now, another advantage of practicing pranayama would be, indirectly, it would help in relaxation. Because as we all know, that practice of or control of breathing is controlling your mind. So indirectly, it would help to relax your nervous system. The autonomic nervous system, you are, up to a certain extent, you are trying to control the autonomic nervous system. So it would be a relaxation for the nervous system. So all these advantages, they can be achieved with the practice of pranayama. The second part, or important part, what we can talk of is the practice of Omkar chanting. Now, I would suggest Omkar chanting is the best solution, but as I have said earlier in the morning sessions also, it can be any music, any mantra, whatever, it would be helpful in improving the emotional attachment, the mental attachment between the baby and the mother. That is important for the emotional bonding, what it is called, between the baby and the mother. Because during pregnancy, the baby can be affected only with one single special sense, and that is the sense of hearing. Now, the sense of hearing is very active, or it is the only sense which can be stimulated during pregnancy for a child, for a baby. Just imagine the child in the mother's womb, in the mother's uterus. It is not in communication with the external world. Its world is only limited to the mother's womb. So it is not in communication with the external world. The eyes of the baby, they are working, but they can't see what is going on in the environment because they are in a closed uterus. So the eyes, they are not going to respond to anything. As far as taste is concerned, the baby is not going to eat anything, so no problem with the taste. As far as touch is concerned, it is only the touch of the fluid around the baby which the baby is sensitive to. No one is going to touch the baby directly, externally as such. No question of smell. The baby is not going to smell anything. The only special sense which can be stimulated by external means is the sense of hearing. So if you are able to stimulate this sense of hearing in a proper way, then you can have, or you can alter the development of the baby. So Omkar chanting, this sound, this now nada of Omkar, any mantra or any music, it can definitely affect the growth of the child. So that is the most important advantage which Omkar chanting can give. It can be mantra or any sound. Because even medically now, it is accepted that the baby, it continuously listens to one single sound throughout the pregnancy, and that sound is mother's heartbeat. Continuously the mother's heart is beating, and it is very near to the baby, so continuously the baby goes on listening to the mother's heartbeat, and it is assurance to the baby that it's safe. When it continuously, a rhythmic mother's heartbeat, it has a positive effect on the growth of the child. And an irregular heartbeat of the mother, it creates fear and anxiety in the child. So it is important that sound is a way which you can influence the baby growing in the uterus. Yes?
I thought babies could hear as well in the uterus.
No.
I read somewhere that the mother went down
for, I don't know. No.
It's curry, they can taste the
It is okay, there are different aversions and desires during pregnancy, but it has nothing to do with the tasting directly by the baby as such. Because when we talk of the sense of taste, unless and until something is put on your tongue, we don't say that the sense of taste is stimulated. So practically, it's not the sense of taste which is stimulated when there are desires and aversions for the mother herself. There is no logical relation between these two things. But when we say of stimulating a sense, ideally taste sense would be only stimulated if you put something on your tongue. That's the only way which we can stimulate the tongue or the taste sensation, otherwise not. Okay, coming back to Omkar chanting. So this is one advantage what we are talking of Omkar chanting. Second advantage of Omkar chanting would be all the advantages of deep breathing, all the advantages of pranayam, you can get it in Omkar chanting. All the things what we talked of. Because Omkar chanting is indirect deep breathing. What do you do when you are chanting Om? Initially, you would take in a deep breath, and when you are breathing out, you would chant Omkar like A, U and Ma. So it is taking in a deep breath, and when you breathe out, you are chanting Om. So it is indirectly you are practicing deep breathing. So all the advantages what we have seen under deep breathing, like oxygen supply, removal of carbon dioxide and the rhythmic movements and everything, these all advantages can be gained with the practice of Omkar chanting. So it's not only the development, the spiritual development of the baby, it is also the advantages of deep breathing which you can get in Omkar chanting. And apart from that, the third and again important thing is the effect on the heart. The vibrations which are generated during the Omkar chanting, they would have a massaging effect over the heart. And if the heart is massaged, anywhere you give a massage, it improves the efficiency. So the efficiency of the heart can be improved with the practice of Omkar chanting. Practically, it is not possible that you open up the chest and give a massage to the heart. So it is an indirect massaging to the heart. The vibrations which are generated, these are the indirect massaging to the heart muscles. So if the heart muscles are massaged, as we all know very well that massage, it improves the blood circulation to that particular organ. So similarly, the blood circulation to the heart muscles would be improved, and the heart can work with more efficiency. So that is another advantage of practicing Omkar chanting during pregnancy. The third thing which is you are all aware of and is the most favorite thing of everyone, I would say, the practice of Yoga Nidra. Yoga Nidra also is going to have some special advantages during pregnancy. Now, it is ideally expected that the mother, she gets enough amount of rest during pregnancy. Ideally, it is said, even the medical text, they say that 8 hours sleep during the night and say a nap of around 1 hour, 1.5 hour during the afternoon, it is essential for a mother during pregnancy. So 8 hours of sleep during night is okay, it can be definitely possible. But what about the nap during the afternoon? Practically for a working mother, it would not be possible to have a nap during the afternoon. Or even during the night, a continuous sleep of 8 hours, it may not be practically possible. So the solution can be practice of Yoga Nidra. Because now we all know that a short duration of practice of Yoga Nidra, it can give you effect, or it can relieve all your problems within a short duration. Like rest, you can rest for a small time and you are relieved for, say it is comparable to a sleep of 2 or 3 hours. So definitely Yoga Nidra, as far as resting is concerned, it is beneficial. And on the other hand, it would help in improving the mental condition, the psychological condition of the mother. Now ideally, the visualization during the Yoga Nidra, it can be slightly changed for pregnant mothers. Like it can be a visualization of probably a normal childbirth, a process of normal childbirth. If the mother is going to visualize it, the fear, the anxiety in the mother's mind, it can be reduced with the practice of yoga nidra. So it is not only rest, physical rest, it is mentally also the mother, she can be calmed down as far as the practice of yoga nidra is concerned. But the visualization, it would be slightly changed. Even you can add a visualization like a normal process of childbirth. And if the mother continuously goes on visualizing that normal process of childbirth, it would change the attitude, it would change the thinking, I would say it would go towards the positive thinking, and this positive thinking, it would help in relieving the fear and anxiety with the practice of yoga nidra. So these are a few I would say basic things, the basic things like practice of pranayama, omkar chanting and yoga nidra, which we have taken note of. The last thing, as I have said, the practice of positions. Practically it would not be possible to talk about each and every position, so we are just not considering the positions. You can just go through the list, what positions can be practiced and what cannot be practiced. But this was I would say in short about practice of yoga during pregnancy. But before you come with the question, I would just answer it on my behalf. What about practice of yoga after childbirth? Okay, practice of yoga during pregnancy is fine, but what about practice of yoga after childbirth? I would say practice of yoga after a normal childbirth can be started right on day 2 or day 1 itself, no problem. It can be started immediately after a normal childbirth. And I need not say here that when I say that immediately after the childbirth, it means that you are going to start from simple arm and limb movements and then go to the complicated things. That's not on directly on day 2, you are not going to suggest shoulder stand and headstand for the mother. So that's a common sense, probably we'll all know it. So from simple things like movements, knee movements, arm movements, leg movements, preparatory movements, they can be started immediately after a normal childbirth. But as far as the surgical childbirth is concerned, surgical is the caesarean sections where actually surgically the baby is delivered. In that case, to be on a safer side, minimum of 6 months, no practice of yoga. At least for 6 months. It is set 3 months. 3 months is sufficient enough. It is good enough for 3 months. But I would say to be on a very safer side, it would be 6 months, no practice of yoga. Or on the other hand, after 3 months, you can, in consultation with the surgeon, depending on the wound, depending on the situation of the stage of the healing of the injury, in consultation with the surgeon, practice of yoga can be started after 3 months, no problem. But if you want to be absolutely on the safe side, wait for 6 months and then the practice of yoga can be started. So after pregnancy, no. 3 months I would not suggest, because pranayama means, ideally if you are talking about pranayama is the tribandhas and the breath holding, then I would not suggest. But simple deep breathing without retention is okay, like 1:1 ratio of 1:1, like you breathe in 4 counts and breathe out in 4 counts. That would be good enough after the wound has healed, if there are some stitches and other things. So probably after 10-15 days when there is the wound has healed completely, then it can be started. Yes.
Even after normal delivery though, you've got to wait till you're ready to settle on it to go back to the same place they were at, and you're still bleeding after 6 weeks.
Yes. In that, basically, as I said, we are going to start with the basic movements, not the yogic positions as such. But in that circumstances, even some books have mentioned that practice of Moolabandha or root lock, it would be helpful even right on second day of childbirth. Like even if there is bleeding, on the second day of childbirth, even the practice of Moolabandha can be helpful, and it helps in bringing back the organs back to their natural position, back to their physiological position. So definitely, yes, it is not directly some difficult postures which are to be practiced, but simple movements, they can be started. But as far as root lock, this specifically I am mentioning this root lock. It has been mentioned in certain books that definitely yes, it can be even started on day 2 to bring back the pelvic organs back to their normal positions. So it can be practiced. And furthermore, whatever I have talked of is all from one book, which is Navayogini Tantra. you must have probably had a look at this book in the shop also, it's available. So whatever queries, because it is just within 45 minutes, I would say covering up 9 months is difficult. So it is just a brief overview of practicing yoga during pregnancy. But for more detailed information, you can refer to one book, which is Nava Yogini Tantra. Now this Nava Yogini Tantra, this book is basically dealing with all the life stages in the woman's life, starting right from puberty, menopause, practice of yoga during pregnancy, practice of yoga during menstruation, anything and everything, practice of yoga for lower backache and all those stuff, anything and everything related with yoga, practice of yoga and women, you would get an answer in this book. So after this, maybe you can refer to this for more detailed information, Nava Yogini Tantra. Yeah?
So when you say, going back to the Oscar chanting about the spiritual developing and the connection between the mother and the baby, does that also help once the baby is born? Like if the baby becomes calmer and once the baby is
Yeah, yeah, sure. Yeah. It is once the baby is born, then it is applicable to, as we say always, Omkar chanting can calm down your mind. It is applicable to the baby also. Just listening to Omkar chanting, it can calm down the baby. A crying baby or irritable baby, I would say, it can calm down up to a certain extent if continuously Omkar chanting, the baby is listening to Omkar chanting. Definitely, yes.
What do you think is better, Omkar or Mota?
Omkar or?
Mota.
Depends on the choice of the mother. There can't be a specific answer for this. Because anyone responds different to different things. So it is again depending on the mother and the baby to what the baby is responding. There are, I say that Omkar chanting is makes the baby calm and quiet. There are certain babies when you are being very violent to them, they are happy. Just take a baby and throw it in the air and again catch hold of that baby. Sometimes the baby is very happy with that. So I mean, you have no explanation for that, why this happened. But then okay, the baby is happy with it. And then after that the baby becomes calm and quiet.